Kilda, welcome back to TVNZ Football Club for 2019. On today's show, Abby Erceg to unretire. The Phoenix are suddenly on fire and United are good again, thanks to that man, Ole Gunnar Solskjaer. On the couch today, welcome Tom Sermanni and Simon Plumb. Tom, obviously some pretty good news for you over the last few days with Abby Erceg announcing she's back for you.
It's certainly very positive. It's good to have her back in the fold, back in the team, back in the programme, and it's a big boost for us.
You said when you first came over here that it was going to be a priority to talk to her, and then you had a cup of tea before qualifiers. Has it been easy to sort of convince her to come back into the fold?
Our conversations from the word go were all very positive, but obviously it wasn't one of those decisions that she could make instantly. I think, you know, the team had a really, really good day together as a group leading into New Caledonia, and Abby came along to that day, and they did a lot of talking and a lot of things that went on last year, and I think that was a big step and a big positive part of the reason that she's decided to come back.
It's a bit of a jump start for football news this year, isn't it? Obviously, it's been all about summer sports, but obviously this is huge for football.
Absolutely. It's got a real bit of momentum behind the Ferns now. I mean, if you scan back a few months, it was a pretty dark time for New Zealand football, but obviously new coach coming in with Tom and a couple of players coming back to the team. There's a real feel of freshness about it and some new hope for the World Cup.
Do you feel like you've got much time between now and June when you've got your first game at the World Cup?
There's usually never enough time. In this case, obviously time is tight, and because of circumstances last year, which kind of saw the programme dormant for quite a long period of time, you know, ideally sort of some of the stuff that we're doing now would have been ideal to have done this time last year. But it is what it is. I think we've got a good programme together through to the World Cup. We've got a great set of players. You know, we've got a good balance in the team. We've got players that have played together for a significant period of time, and that in itself helps. If it was a team that was very much in changeover mode, then the task would be much more difficult.
You must feel like you've got this fresh signing, a 29-year-old with 132 caps. She's been to three World Cups, three Olympics. That's a massive wealth of experience to just pop into the team and say, there you go, there's one of the world's best defenders.
Yeah, and very much at the peak of her career. So, you know, when you talk about international teams and particularly teams like in New Zealand who have a smaller playing base, or your critical players are even more critical than your bigger teams.
Obviously, international football as well. You've only got the pool of players to select in front of you, really, don't you? So it's a pretty big boost.
It's a huge boost. And I think, I mean, you used the word dormant before, Tom. I think that's a perfect way of kind of summing the programme up prior to you coming in. But I guess on the flip side, you've got some really good games leading into the World Cup. I mean, for New Zealand, it must be very hard to actually attract solid games. But I think you're playing four of the top 10.
Yeah, we probably are. Yeah, we've got a first tournament in Australia in February, March, and then we've got a game in the US, and then a couple of other games that sort of lined up that just need to be signed off but are virtually sort of signed, sealed and delivered.
Nice. How handy is it that you've got that game in Australia? Because you're based over in Sydney, aren't you?
I am. I've got a home game. They're actually playing about a mile from where I live, so I can just stay at home and come to the game.
So you're hosting drinks if you get the win, obviously.
If we get the win, the drinks are on me.
And
if not, I'm going home on malt.
How good is it to have that base quite close with the players being able to come back and have those games to prepare?
Oh, look, it's really good. You know, it's ironic that, you know, a few years ago this would be a fantastic fixture. You say, right, we're just in New Zealand, all we need to do is go across to Australia. The reality of the modern day game is we've got 15 or 16 players who are in Europe who are having to make that trek back. But no, it's great. And I think it's a relationship we need to keep building. That trans-Tasman competition is something that hasn't sort of quite happened as it used to. And I think it'd be good to get that back. And it's a great benchmark for our team to see where we're at this period in time.
Do you think it's something that New Zealand football has fallen short on over the past few years, having those relationships, the networks that you have in world football, to be able to say, right, let's organise a friendly because we need these games?
I'm not sure if that's necessarily the case. I think it's just sometimes the game moves in different directions. And then you sort of then start to lose those connections or those kind of games. And I think with the way the women's game over the last few years has gone, where the majority of players are spread all over the world, to get those sort of local games becomes much more complex than it used to be when the players were all in New Zealand and all in Australia.
Mm. You managed to do a bit of scouting when you were over in Europe for the draw. Who did you see? Where did you go?
Yeah, I did a little bit of, I would like to say, ducking and diving around the place, but that's not quite the right expression. I went over to the UK. I caught up with, you know, we've got four players playing in the WSL over there, spent some good time with them. Caught up with some coaches, caught up with my Scottish counterpart up in Scotland. So, yeah, it was a good exercise. I had a chat to Phil Neville about, you know, the opportunity to play England. And, yeah, so it ended up being a very beneficial, albeit very cold, trip.
Back to the winter.
Back to reality.
How are you finding life in New Zealand? Between Sydney and New Zealand?
Much better. I've become a very hot climate person now. And I've lost all that Scottish toughness over the years.
Simon can relate. He lost his British toughness a long time ago.
Oh, I don't know about that.
Very good. So, Netherlands, Canada, Cameroon. They're in your group.
Yep.
Tough games.
Mm. Yeah.
How do you see you matching up against them?
I think we're competitive against them. You're never going to get a great draw when you're in the third pot. That's a reality. They're all games that are going to be tight. They're all games where all the teams in the group think they can win the games. So it's one of those groups where I don't think there's a team that you say, okay, that team's unlikely to win. And I think, you know, if you look in the last World Cup, New Zealand played Canada and played Holland. Both games were really tight. The African countries are always competitive. So it's a group that gives us a good chance, but we know we'll need to be at our best to win games and to get through to the next round.
Big few months ahead. We'll take a break now. After the break, we're going to have a look at the impact of new coaches like Tom, Ole Gunnar Solskjaer and Mark Rudan reaping rewards after some fantastic results. That's up soon. So the Phoenix are 8 games unbeaten, came back against the Central Coast Mariners at the bottom of the table to win 3-2. Mm-hmm. What's going on at the Phoenix?
Who knows? Mark Rudan, by the looks of it, is doing a great job. Up to 5th now in the table. And it's great to see, really. I mean, the Phoenix have struggled for quite a few years just to try and get a foothold, and even to the point where the actual licence has been in jeopardy. Crowds not turning up, not really getting results on the pitch, but like you say, 8 games unbeaten, you can't really complain with that, and that will draw people into the stadium. If they can keep this going and get some stability, it could be huge for the club and for Kiwi football.
He had quite an emotive press conference after that game, and he sort of said, look, guys, get behind us. Wherever you are in the country, we're the representative for professional football in New Zealand. Mm. He's sort of the breath of fresh air that they needed, wasn't he?
Very impressed. I've known Mark. I coached Mark when I was at the Institute of Sport, and he was a scholarship holder then, so I've known him scarily for over 25 years. And it's amazing how time flies on. But I've been very impressed with what he's done. But the great thing that he's done for me is that he's sort of served a coaching apprenticeship. He's gone into the State League in New South Wales, coached at Sydney United and Rockdale, a Macedonian and a Croatian club. And that's a really good breeding ground for your coach to hone your coaching skills. And to improve your management and your football skills, etc. And I think, you know, he's come into this job, and I've listened to him. He's been very open. He's expressed how he feels about things in a very honest and positive way. He's obviously got a good rapport with the players, but very demanding of the players. And I've watched the team play a few times, and their actual on-field organisation is first class. You know, so I think, you know, he's done a terrific job there.
And do you think the fact that he's got that, he's sort of creating more of an identity around the club with young local players like Sarpreet Singh, who's been in such good form, does that help to try and get people behind them? They can say, oh, this is our team, it's our players.
No doubt. When he first got the job, he made a remark about it was quite hard to attract good players to the Phoenix because of the history of the club. And that even went for Kiwi players, which is really quite worrying when you think about it. But what he's managed to do and get some real spirit into this squad and give the brand some identity and get people behind it, he can only really deserve credit for the job he's done. And if this is early days, if he can keep it going, it could be huge for the club.
How easy is it for the Phoenix to hold on to a coach like that? I don't want everyone getting up in arms, me suggesting that he could be on his way already.
There are rumours.
There have been a few rumours.
It's not surprising, and that's the sad thing about the modern game. There's this instant either sacking of coaches or instant of poaching of coaches in some ways. It probably is not helped by the two new teams that are coming into the A-League next year, particularly the Sydney team, which is almost local to where Mark is from. But, I think knowing him and knowing what he's built here, for him to move on, I think, is a big risk for him. I think he's beginning to establish something here, and that's very important as a coach as well as, you know, as a player. And I think he'll stay here. Mm. And continue the job because he looks very attached to it.
Mm. Another manager who is doing some pretty good work, but less certainty around his future prospects, Ole Gunnar Solskjaer. Mm. 6 wins on the trot. First time that's ever been done at Manchester United.
Yeah, which is also quite surprising, really. You would have thought they'd have strung a few wins together in their time, but he's done a great job.
For a new manager, so obviously when Fergie came in, under the pump a little bit.
Right, yeah. I mean, he's bonded the players together. I mean, if you even look at statistics of how much players are running and sprinting, you'll see that since Mourinho left and Solskjaer came in, it's gone way up. So the players are obviously playing for Solskjaer, they're playing for the badge, and they're playing for each other. And it's shown in the results. I mean, they've had a couple of dolly games against some pretty lower teams.
Don't say Tottenham.
But Tottenham was really their first test, and they passed it. I mean, maybe Tottenham deserved to win the game, but they didn't, you know. They got a job done.
Yeah. Do you think it says something about the players, though, the likes of Pogba, who was so average beforehand, and then a new manager comes in and all of a sudden they start playing again? I mean, what does that say about them having professional pride?
It says both things. It says a little bit about the players, but also says a bit about the management, in the sense that, you could see from the outside and all the press and all the things surrounding United prior to Solskjaer coming in, it was all kind of negative, and with that, then what tends to happen is that confidence tends to erode. Players tend to then sort of protect themselves, and they don't go out there with that confidence or enthusiasm, and results then sort of start to tumble. And I think with him coming in and brightening up the environment, that gives an immediate boost. How long that boost lasts depends on a whole range of factors because, the honeymoon period doesn't last forever.
Mm-hmm. If they're looking for, say, a Scotsman to take the helm for a number of years, you're not putting your hand up?
No, I'm not back there in winter.
Fair enough. So. We've noticed you're quite prolific on social media.
Mm. I am. And I've actually... this sounds terrible. I've kind of reached big-time social media because I don't do it myself.
Oh, really?
Oh, you've got a
big
minion.
Time.
I've got a Twitter. I don't know. Is it a Twitterer?
Yes.
Twitter?
Yes.
Twitter.
Twit.
My media person in Orlando, Jackie, who was great. She was great. She actually does it. So I sort of send her stuff. And I often don't know. I don't know what's on there. I don't know how to get on
it. It's brilliant, by the way.
That shows how good technology is.
I'm a little bit disappointed because I thought you were just generating all this good content.
I'm behind it. You know, I'm kind of pulling the strings, but...
You're taking the photos and stuff.
Yeah, I do all that stuff. I do all the groundwork and I send all the information and Jackie polishes it up and sends it out.
Classic manager move. Your Bitmoji, did you create your own Bitmoji?
Yeah, no, I did. Well, see, there's a couple of things. Yes, I created my original Bitmoji. The New Zealand players came in and changed it in New Caledonia. It got mixed reviews, if I'm being honest. It made me just a wee bit too grey, I think. My wife was like, you know,
I like the shades.
Yeah, the shades are okay. And then my wife did a little bit of tampering with it recently, so it's kind of in its...
It's an evolving being.
Full team effort. When are we going to start seeing video posts?
Probably when I can learn to do them. I'll get on to that. I'll get something and get on to that.
Yeah, no, we do appreciate it. And obviously, we look forward to the tweet of you promoting our show as well with your TVNZ Football Club mug.
Yeah.
That is going to be us for this week. Thank you very much for coming in and joining us. Happy New Year to you. Yeah. Hopefully, we'll see you again soon. Remember, you can catch us on the One News website, YouTube and Facebook pages, or as a podcast on iTunes and SoundCloud. Just search TVNZ Football Club. We'll see you next time.